Good afternoon. Welcome to Education Today. I'm your host, Kitty Kelly Epstein. You're listening on KPFA 94.1 FM, airing all throughout Northern California, and on www.kpfa.org worldwide. Today, we're going to take apart a couple of school board elections in the Bay Area. As you know, there have been huge political battles in both Richmond and Oakland about people trying to take over our school districts. And for a bunch of different self-centered kind of reasons that didn't seem to us to have very much to do with kids. And so every year, school board elections are nail biters. This year in Oakland, we even had Jerry Brown start a PAC, which he ridiculously named United Teachers of Oakland, with no teachers in it, and spent tens of thousands of dollars trying to get a couple people elected. But in at least one case, he failed, and the person seems not to have been elected. More on that later. It's given some heart to community-based organizers to have some success against even the tens and hundreds of thousands of dollars that are being spent by some people trying to influence our school boards. So we're going to start with West Contra Costa. The progressives on the West Contra Costa School Board got a sort of a majority a couple of years ago. Demetrius Gonzalez Hoy was elected to the school board yesterday, and he is with us on Education Today to tell us more about what's going on in West Contra Costa, what the effect of the school board elections are, and so on. Demetrius, welcome to Education Today.
Hi, Kitty. Good afternoon. Thank you for having me.
I'm so happy to get a chance to talk to you because things are always interesting in both West Contra Costa and Oakland, and you guys seem to be making some progress the last couple of years. So I wonder if you can tell us what effect this current election is going to have on the district. And I should remind our guests that in Oakland, we have ranked choice voting, but I believe in West Contra Costa, you do not, right? You have straight up old-fashioned elections.
That's correct.
Is that right?
Yes.
Okay.
Yep.
Nothing disparaging about old-fashioned. A lot of people would prefer to have those, but but they are different from what we're doing around here. Okay. So tell me about the effect it's likely to have on the district.
Yeah. No. Thank you. Like you mentioned, I got elected last night with 70% of the votes, which is an amazing feeling. I'm so honored. A colleague of mine was also running, and she also got reelected. We were not running together. We have been, unfortunately, in opposition for the last year or so. Our board is currently divided. We have two school board members on one side and two on the other, and we have a swing vote in the middle. We're not always united, but we face very similar issues, just like in Oakland. We have a lot of students who, unfortunately, are falling through the cracks, and we're trying to figure out how to ensure that they have all the supports and everything they need to succeed in our schools. Right now, our schools have about 20. We have about 26,000 students. It has declined in the last decade, in part because of growth of charter schools, but also in part because we have lost a lot of students after the pandemic. So we're focusing on increasing our enrollment and fixing the issues that families say that they are seeing in our schools, from safety to equity, because our data has shown that our students of color, African-American and Latino students, are the ones that are falling through the cracks. So that has been a big focus of some of us on the board and the new superintendent, Dr. Hurst, which is one of the things I like about him, that we are truly focused on equity, on what are the needs of each school, because each one of our schools, we have five cities in West Contra Costa, and each city is very different.
Can you tell me, you said that there were disagreements on your board. But you also said that you've got a superintendent now that you like and that's really focused on, I guess, kids and teachers and making the schools better. So what are the disagreements on the board?
Yeah, I mean, the thing I like about our superintendent, I think he's an educator, so he understands the problem in an urban setting school. Yeah, that's his background. Right now, we are really focused on tackling the lack of staff in our schools. When we opened our schools, we had 50 open teaching spots, and it could have been a lot worse because over the summer we had close to 300 teaching spots open, and about 200 classified spots. So we were in a really bad place. Thankfully, we did recruiting, but we're still having a hard time getting teachers to come to our district and stay. So we're really focused on that, collaborating with labor. We're in negotiations with labor. So that is a big focus right now of our superintendent, and I believe he really truly understands that part. The disagreements on our board, you know, we just have a different approach. We have two educators, myself and one of my colleagues who were teachers, and another one who was a classified staff. So, you know, we most of the time really understand the issues at the school side. So, the other two board members are parents in our schools, which is great. But our approaches can be very different. So, we sometimes disagree on what the priority should be. For example, to me right now, it should be about teaching and learning, ensuring every single student has the qualified educator, because research shows that's how you develop students who are ready for the next steps in both elementary and secondary schools. So that is my biggest focus right now, ensuring that we have qualified teachers in every classroom.
So can you also tell me, so you have faced, as Oakland has, a certain amount of state interference with your decisions, kind of different ways that FICMAT, the state, the county, different agencies have tried to tell you what to do. Is that still an issue in West Contra Costa?
Yeah, it's still an issue. Thankfully, we're not at the place where Oakland has been, because obviously they have lost larger control in their financial decisions. We do have a financial advisor that ultimately has veto power in what we spend and our budget from the county, Contra Costa County. But thankfully, we are actually right now on our way to have a positive certification in our budget by this December, because we have been making some very difficult but positive decisions in our budget. And with the state giving us more funding this past spring, we're actually on our way to be completely self-sufficient and not having this advice from the county. And that also includes what I believe is to be also providing labor and our teachers and classified staff salary increases this fall. So I'm really happy that we're heading in that direction, because then we don't need to, ask permission from the county for us to make our own decisions and it comes to our budget.
Fantastic. Congratulations to you. And one other
Thank
thing
you.
That's an issue here in Oakland is the issue of closures. Are you contemplating closing schools?
No. And that's one of the things that I am very thankful. Majority of our board, my allies on the board have made it very explicit to our superintendent and staff that we will not even consider school closures. I think that the beautiful thing about public education is that families are able to choose a school that's close to them, right? That provides them everything that they need, right? That's why we also value community schools in West Contra Costa. And I know Oakland does as well. And closure of schools doesn't ultimately help you fix your budget. It is a very, very small savings that you save by closing a school, right? So actually what we're trying to concentrate is increasing the enrollment of our schools. That's how you fix the budget, right? Fixing the issues that families tell us are a problem of why they're leaving, right? And are choosing to go to a charter school or a private school. The closure of schools is really a temporary Band-Aid that doesn't ultimately help. It just creates trauma on our community. So that's one thing I'm thankful that we're not considering and haven't considered in fixing our budget.
I'm so happy to hear you say that, because I have done a lot of research and reporting on the issue of school closures. It absolutely does not save money. In some cases, it costs money. In fact, in Washington, D.C., it actually costs them $40 million or something to close some schools. So I'm really happy to hear you say that that's your position. Another issue that's big in a lot of school districts is the question of focus on test scores. Like, you know, this over periods of time, the state and the federal government have pressured us about test scores, or they've used that as an excuse to close schools or to take over districts. This has been a huge issue. And then, of course, the effect that it has on kids and families. So I wonder if that's an issue in your district.
Well, I mean, definitely testing is a conversation everywhere, right? We just, our last school board meeting, we spent almost 3 hours looking at test scores and the data that comes from that. And you know, test scores can be good metrics to see where we are. But at the end of the day, as a public school teacher, I know that these tests are grounded in racism to some extent. And they don't ultimately tell us how the teaching and learning is going at the schools. Because looking at our data, it shows a very different picture than when I go visit the schools. And I see that there's so much learning happening every single day. And, you know, that's why I'm a huge opponent of using test scores to give financial incentives or anything like that to school districts. Because we are concentrating on the whole child. We're concentrating on the needs of students, on the the social emotional supports, and of course their education, but we don't concentrate just on testing, because as a English language learner myself, I'll tell you that I was never a good test taker, and we have, you know, 12,000 English language learners in our district, so of course our test scores are going to look lower, because tests are not made for people like me, right? So I'm not a proponent of that. Of course, it's important to look at metrics, but I push for local metrics. For example, testing that is developed at our schools, right, by teachers and administrators that students are used to and can be differentiated for anyone at whatever level they are academically.
So I'm really happy to hear you say that too, because I teach teachers and I talk a lot about standardized tests, and then I give them a quiz and they're like, well, I thought you didn't believe in tests. No, it's not that I don't believe in tests. If I teach you something and I want you to have the opportunity to put together the different pieces of what we've been learning about so that you can, you know, can you relate it on a test, then that's good for you, and that gives me a chance to see what you've learned. But if I give you a test out of the blue on some items that you've never heard of and never had a chance to study, that's a whole different thing. So so I'm happy to hear your view about that. And is that something that you work on explaining to parents? Because sometimes, you know, parents kind of pay some attention to those scores, and that may not be so great for the kids because the kids may feel like they're doing something wrong.
Yeah, no, I always encourage parents to go and talk to their teacher, because I completely agree with you. A student is more than a test score, right? And what happens, you know, all of our students depend on the food we give them at the schools, and they come with a lot of trauma from the community. So what if they're having an off day on the day that this test is provided, right? They're more than just that day's score, right?
Right.
And they might be succeeding in other areas that are not being tested. So I always encourage parents to go and talk to the teacher, find out more about how they're doing, and potentially getting involved, because I totally agree with you. I mean, it's good to know. And parents should ask for, you know, test scores, of course, because they need to know how their student's doing academically. But it's more than that, right?
Right. I'm so happy to have a chance to talk to you, and I know our listeners are happy to get to know somebody from the West Contra Costa School Board who is singing a lot of the same tunes that we're singing here on KPFA. So thank you so much for being with us.
Thank you, Katie. Thank you for inviting me. I appreciate it.
Yes. Next we're going to talk to somebody from Oakland who is a parent advocate. Kim Davis has done parent advocacy work for a number of years, and she's going to be talking with us about the school board races in Oakland. There are three school board seats that were up this year in Oakland, and although there are still ballots that are out, I'm wanting to ask him how comfortable she is with thinking that we have some certainty about who has won in these various seats. Again, for people who don't live in Oakland, we have ranked choice voting, and we also have mail-in ballots, so people have a while to get their ballots in. But sometimes we have a pretty good idea the day after the election who it is who's likely to win. So Kim Davis, welcome to Education Today. And I'm wondering what you're thinking about those races.
Thank you, Kitty. Thank you so much for having me. And as you said, there are just, you know, it's hard to know at this point. There are so many votes that are outstanding. And, you know, with the Veterans Day holiday, it may even be into next week that we get a final answer. But, you know, what we do know right now is that the voters are overwhelmingly supporting grassroots candidates that have not been backed by billionaires, who are really down with the community and understand what we need in our community schools. So we are really optimistic that, you know, one of two candidates in each of these districts who is a grassroots community aligned candidate is going to end up winning in at least two of those three seats, which is going to give us the majority of the board that we need to make sure that we're, you know, working with our students, our parents, our educators, and creating really a racially just district that invests in classrooms and not downtown in our central administration, which is what we tend to do now.
Yeah. There are two people that, when I look at the numbers, look likely to win. At least I know there's three possible ones in district, for people who know our districts in Oakland. In District 6, it looks like there's a strong woman candidate who is likely to win. And in District 2 also. Is that pretty much your estimate?
Well, definitely right now they're leading, and with particularly in District 2 with a really good margin. And, you know, like I said, because we have ranked choice voting, which you mentioned, and we have aligned candidates, values aligned candidates in each of the districts, we're likely to see through that ranked choice that those numbers will go up. So, yes, right now we're feeling pretty comfortable. But, of course, you know, the voters need to be heard, so we will be waiting to hear, along with everybody else, what the final answer is going to be.
So if it is the case that these community-aligned board members are elected, it may change to some extent what's likely to happen on some important issues in the district, I believe. So one major issue that a lot of people have heard about around the Bay Area is the whole issue of closing schools. Oakland over the last 20 years has closed more than 20, I think 30 schools, mostly in black neighborhoods. And we know that the effect of this is to encourage gentrification and, of course, to make families and kids miserable by having to move to a different school for no good reason, in my opinion, because as I was discussing with our previous guest, it doesn't save any money at all. So is school closures likely to continue to be an issue if some of these new candidates win?
Well, you know, that really has been a defining issue in this race throughout the city, really. People are talking about how this is really negatively impacting kids, and particularly, as you mentioned, in black communities and black and brown students. And so, you know, the grassroots candidates, and there were six of them that ran, two in each district, each have said they're going to put an end to school closures, and they're going to rescind the closures even that we had for this year. So, you know, I think the school closure issue will be something that dies at the end of this current term with the board that we've had for the last really 20 years, kind of pushing this sort of top-down school closure policy, which, as you said, it doesn't save money, and it also doesn't improve outcomes for kids, and that's what's really important. So, you know, absolutely, I believe that the, you know, that this election will mean we actually can transform this district really into a community-driven, community school district that values its students and its families and its educators and is really, you know, accountable to those communities for the decisions that we make.
It sounds beautiful. And let me ask you this also. So the other thing, there are many issues in every district, and, you know, and some of them seem inescapable in a certain way. But another one that's plagued Oakland is this ongoing essential control by the state, which was imposed on us by then State Senator Don Parada and Mayor at the time Jerry Brown. And they got the district taken over by the state and imposed a $100 million loan, which Oakland did not need, did not ask for, and did not spend. It was spent pretty much entirely by state administrators after they took away all the power of the school board. And we did not have a $100 million debt. So I've said this a few times on the show, so I won't say more about it again. But my question is, I wonder how this, if there is a new sort of majority on the school board in Oakland, how you think they're going to deal with the ongoing interruption and vetoes and so on of the fiscal crisis management team, various trustees, various people from the county. How do you think the board will deal with those if there is a new majority?
Yes, it's so interesting that you mentioned Jerry Brown, because he's played already an outsized influence in this election, having dumped, I don't know, $160,000 or so in a week's time at the end of this election to push the candidate that I'm assuming he is aligned with and will continue that, you know, sort of top-down control that starts with the state. The good news is that we are very close to paying off our state loan. And in fact, current board member Mike Hutchinson, who is running in this race, successfully get a resolution passed that we will pay that off, which will give the state a lot less leverage over the district. But a lot of it also comes from the sort of privatization frame that our school board has had before and since the takeover, that really made the conditions ripe for state interference and for inviting FICMAT to come in and do these sort of draconian cuts and school closures that they've done. So it is an issue that has plagued us for 20 plus years. And I believe that as we turn the page on this old style corporate top-down school board member, and we go to the grassroots school board members who are going to be working in partnership with the communities, understand the community control is super important, not just at the district level, but at the school site level, and that we are not going to be seeing FICMAT and the state interfering. Plus, right now, we're in good financial shape, and we need to make sure we continue that by making better budget decisions, not by closing schools.
So what are you planning, you and the parent advocates that you're working with, planning as kind of next steps if it does turn out to be the case that there is, you know, not that there is a maybe more community oriented board in line who that's less likely to be supportive of things like school closures? What do you think are next steps? What's going to happen next?
You know, the great thing about the way that these elections happened is these candidates, their parents, their teachers, their community organizers. So it is, you know, they're already working with community right now to identify solutions for, you know, for issues that are going to come up. So obviously the most pressing issue will be the school closures. We have 6 schools that are slated to close at the end of this school year. And we need to undo that process. We need to protect those schools, and we need to redirect resources from the overspending that we do downtown and into the classroom and making sure that schools have what they need so that students will succeed. So that's really like a immediate thing. But in the long term, you know, we need to invest in the community schools. We just got $66 million in community school funding that needs to be managed at the site level with parents, community teachers, staff who know what each community needs. We have, you know, we have at this time a larger budget surplus than we've had for years and years and years. So we're in good shape financially, and we need to start making really smart decisions about how we spend that money, because we have not, you know, it's not that we don't have enough money. It's that we're not spending it wisely. And that is going to take us looking at where, you know, what are we spending our money on, and how what is the impact on students? How effective is it? An external audit would be a great thing. And we now know that the Attorney General's office is looking into the school closures as well. And one of the things that the ACLU has asked them to do is also do an audit of how we spend the money that we receive as a district with a lot of high need students. How are we spending those dollars in service of kids?
And I believe, from what I understand, that the Attorney General's investigation is based on some parent or community complaints about the inequity of where the school closures are. I don't support school closures at all. Unless if a whole school gets together and says, we don't think this school is any good, we should close it, maybe. But other than that, I don't support school closures. But in this case, the closures have been so incredibly inequitable as far as affecting Black students in particular. So that's the basis for the Attorney General looking at this, right?
Yes, it is. It's, you know, we closed, I think in 15 years, we closed 18 schools, and 16 of them were at least 60% or more African-American students. And that is, to me, just, you know, a clear sign that we are targeting Black communities for school closures, and that is a violation of their constitutional rights. So that's where it starts. But we also know that in schools where you have a lot of Black students, you also tend to have a lot of Latino or Latina students as well, and other students who are also needing the same kinds of resources, and making sure that we're getting the dollars that we're earning from the state through the local control funding formula to the schools and to the students who need them. So, it, you know, while it is started as a certainly as part of the reparations campaign and really looking into the disparate impact on Black students, it is certainly not going to be limited to that as we go forward, we hope.
Thank you so much. Thank you, Kim Davis, for being with us. I really appreciate all the information and wisdom you have brought to us. And we're going to be wrapping up the show. I want to thank our guests and our producer and the KPFA staff. And I want to remind our listeners that we are now on every week and at 2:30 in the afternoon on Wednesday. And we're interested in hearing from you about your ideas about shows. And I usually put something about our show on my Facebook page, which is Kitty Kelly Epstein. And thank you so much for being with us. Bye-bye. I'll send you a note. Okay, bye.
Starting at 3 p.m. with Upfront PM with Scott Baba highlighting the standout segments from the Upfront Morning Show. At 4 p.m. it's News, Views, and Hip Hop on Hard Knock Radio with Davey D and Anita Johnson. At 5 p.m. it's Frontline Investigative Reporting on Flashpoints with Dennis Bernstein and the Flashpoints crew. Then at 6 p.m. catch up with all the news stories of the day on the Pacifica Evening News. That's afternoons on KPFA and KPFA.org.
listening to 94.1 KPFA, 89.3 KPFB in Berkeley, 88.1 KFCF in Fresno, 97.5 K24 8BR in Santa Cruz, and online worldwide at kpfa.org.